Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the World Championship Series Europe Grand Final for Season 2. Back with Todd right now after a victory. How does that feel? Sweet, isn't it? You are now officially, this is quite rare, the four of you are the only Europeans to play on finals day at WCS Europe since Stefano did in Season 1.
I feel good. I feel like half the man Stefano is now.
Half the man.
Yeah, only
he's
half
probably
the
watching right now, yeah.
It was 2v2.
You guys took that very seriously.
Why would we not?
It's supposed to be a fun game.
With all the bragging and teasing, you really think I'm going to lose to TLO? No, I don't think so.
Best cast at EU. Now best player cast at EU. It's a good title.
I lost to Red twice the last time I met him.
Okay,
so.
All right. Bit of fun, but it's good fun, good natured fun, and obviously a good win for you guys. Let's move on to the final now. These two, I mean, what more can we say about them? They've had a terrific tournament, however it finishes up for them, but I guess Sam might be the more disappointed of the two if he weren't to take home a title now.
Yeah, in the previous match, but in the direct comparison, like when they are going to face now, I don't think it matters all that much. It's crazy to think that these two, I think they have like the best ratios overall in terms of win-loss, and they meet in the finals now, so I guess the stats do make sense.
Yeah, see TLO as well.
TLO now?
Shot down. So let's take a little bit of a closer look at statistics while we're on the subject of that with San. Hopefully we can see those in a moment. He has a terrific record. We've talked about his PVZ. We said it was amazing, but to be honest, he struggled against Golden. Golden gave him a really, really tough game. Mentally, how is he going to think about that now? I know it's a different matchup, but is he going to be a little bit tortured by that? Maybe a little seed of doubt in there?
Maybe a little bit, yeah. He has to somehow move on from that, but if he hasn't been able to identify why he was playing worse than usual, assuming that's what the conclusion he came up to, which is my guess, he might be thinking, wow, what if I play also below my level against StarDust? I'm going to have to be on my A game, so he's going to have to be careful.
So they're smiling and joking over there, I tell you. This doesn't feel like a tense grand final between these two, because they're obviously very good friends, so that's going to play its part in this match, but I think once the 3-2-1 goes down and they're in game, the gloves are off then, aren't they?
Yeah, last time I saw two protosses joke around like this, it was Katowice finals, before finals, and once the game started, then fireworks went off immediately with SOS starting to proxy and all that. There was no more friendship that counted anymore, and I expect the same here. I expect fireworks.
These two were both, of course, in the round of 8 last season. Stardust crashed out of that place, and Sam went one step further to the semi-final. So they've both done much better than he did last season, when I think there was a little bit more expectation on them as well. But look at that record right now. In WCS all-time, 71 wins, 19 losses for Stardust. That's a terrific stat, however you want to put it up.
That's the opposite of my stats.
I was actually going to compliment you on the fact that you, this season, finally got yourself into the, you know, a decent place, round of 16, and you got yourself on the winner's ladder. And then you just blew it.
I could have seen that one coming. It's very tough. Like when you meet players like MC, San, and all that very early on in the tournament, like it's 32 players. There are a lot of top caliber players like these guys.
But the good news for you is you're back in Premier League for season 3. So automatically there because you were top 16 this season. So that's good.
I would have qualified anyway, but...
Oh, fighting talk from the Todd. I like it. Also, Todd, by the way. What was it short for? What's your nickname short for?
Mastodons.
Yeah, Mastodons. So in English, that's like a mammoth.
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah, so it's kind of... It's quite appropriate for you.
Yeah. I'm not sure what you expect me to say.
I was trolling you badly, but it didn't work. The players are almost ready for the map veto. Of course, they're not going to veto any maps this time around. It's literally just about which order they're going to play them in. They're going to play all 7 potentially as well. That's going to play its part here. If this goes all the way and we have to play all 7 maps in this one, there's a couple in there I know both these players don't like.
Yeah. I don't think it matters all that much in Mirror. Like usually there is a few maps that you dislike a little bit more. And even though they are going to be like clear vetoes, like I'm expecting Alter Zim and Waystation most likely here to be vetoed.
No vetoes.
Oh yeah.
That's what I'm saying. It's no vetoes, it's best of 7 now.
Yeah.
So they've got to play them all if we play 7 maps.
They're probably going to be playing them last.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I mean, they know how to play them, surely. Like, usually these are not maps that you veto on ladder. Maybe Waystation. So if they were to play on Waystation, then I guess they would be quite inexperienced.
Ooh, what do you know?
Oh my god, Sen. I mean, Sen has been so solid.
What do you
if you
know?
Think about it, in macro games where you take a second base, a third base, and all that, he's been so solid that I'm not actually that surprised that he takes Waystation against somebody who likes to play aggressive.
And I know StarDust doesn't like Waystation. It's one of the maps he told me he didn't want to play. So that's a good one for Sen in a way, to get that one up early. It depends on how the first game goes. And also, we haven't even spoken about tactics just yet. In best of sevens, this is what StarDust loves, because he has the complete repertoire. He can do whatever he likes over seven games. You never know what's going to come.
He has the complete repertoire, but he's up against the complete package. Apollo just... Yeah, I mean, Sen just knows how to adapt very well. He knows how to proxy himself. We saw him proxy in a previous tournament and do it quite successfully as well. So he knows how to counter it as well. I tried to proxy him in WCS round of 32.
Yes.
Didn't go well. Even though he was playing from Korea, no problem, easy peasy. So honestly, seven maps, I don't expect any of them to proxy a single time.
Do we think it might well be seven maps? Is it going to be that close, or is one going to stretch out, do you think, here?
I feel like if either of them gains a lot of momentum, like wins two maps in a row, then he's just going to ace it. So it's unlikely.
Okay. Thank you very much, Todd. And thank you for this entire weekend. Of course, it's great to have you back with us for the round of eight and our finals today. Our semi-finals were terrific. Can the final live up to the billing? Let's hope so. One match between two men to decide the WCS European champion for 2014 in season two. Let's go over to the commentators for your grand final, Kolaris and Apollo.
All right, grand finals time here at WCS Europe, season two for 2014, as we have two of the best Protoss players here in Europe fighting for the final.
Absolutely. I'm so hyped to see which player is going to take the second season of this year here from the Europe Premier League. Which one will it be? And we're here to find out. Best of seven. It could be short. It could be very fast and sweet, or it could go long. You know, we don't really know what's going to happen here. But for sure, make sure that you get to Twitter and get out there and tell everybody that the grand finals is about to happen. Kolaris is on Twitter. I'm on Twitter. Go there now. Retweet, tweet, retweet, tweet, tweet, tweet. And make sure to get people watching, because we are going to have a lot of fun here for this best of seven. It is time, Kolaris. Which player are you favoriting coming into this?
I've got a favorite, Sen. I've got to stick with him. You know, going into this, it's actually very, very even between both of them. They're very, very close to one another. But very importantly, they already played each other this season. They already played one another in the round of 16.
And who came out on top, Kolaris?
It was Sen. He came out 2-0.
And I remember casting those games, and he looked like a different player. He looked like an upper level to StarDust in those games. What StarDust tried didn't work. Mm. What Sen tried did work. It was very simple. But we're about to find out if StarDust can get his second championship. His DreamHack Summer 1 last year in 2013 was the start of his career.
Yeah.
Was where he made a big name for himself, shooting to the top, beating the likes of Jadong and beating a bunch of other fantastic players on the way. And now we could also see if Sen can finally get what he wants. After all this time, he's won some other tournaments, but this is the one that he's interested in. He wants to play at the global finals like StarDust does. And with a victory here today, if Sen wins this best of seven, he will be the number one ranked player in the world within mm-hmm. the WCS ranking system. MC has held that throne for a while. And we saw Sen beat him 3-1 yesterday, eliminating him in the quarterfinals. Has now found himself in the grand finals, and he can overtake the boss DOS to be number one. If StarDust wins, he would find himself third in the ranking system. Two positions for both of these players, which would find it very difficult not to see them at the global finals at the end of the year.
All right, the grand final is upon us. Both of these players had a meteoric rise to the top, and now it's time for them to butt heads, clash. One of these players will be our WCS Europe champion for season two, as we have spawning to the bottom right-hand corner our red Protoss, representing my insanity. Give it up for StarDust!
Whoa.
Crowd seems behind StarDust so far, before we really start this.
And up to the top left, we have our blue Protoss player representing Yo Flash Wolves. It's San. Wait a minute. Let's do that again. All right, guys. Up to the top left, spawning as our blue Protoss, it's San. That's better.
Do you know what Red Eye reminds me of? You know when you used to play Roller Coaster Tycoon,
yeah,
and the people got bored in the queue,
yeah,
and you used to buy like a panda that dances.
We need to get him a panda suit.
He's the entertainer. He's the hyper. He's the entertainer. He's getting the crowd pumped for the grand finals here.
Wow!
And we've started off with quite ordinary builds by both players here. Both double gases down. We see StarDust, who's actually scouting a little bit more here. And I actually agree with what Todd said before. I don't think we'll see many proxies in this game because both of these players have won games, they've lost games on proxies, and they just know the inside and outside of early proxy gates where it's not going to really give them a significant advantage or even an easy way to a victory. So yeah. I don't really see that happening, like Todd said, throughout this best of seven at all.
So StarDust playing extra, extra safe here in the very beginning of this.
You know, early proxies, I'm talking about like gateway attacks and stuff, but what we're seeing from StarDust here, on a map like King Sejong Station, it's really easy to hide buildings elsewhere, in the middle of the game. So not like an early proxy here, but this most likely, it could be a Stargate, but I'm thinking it might be a Twilight Council or something.
And the location is so hard to scout out. If you want to scout out with this probe, you have to go all the way around this direction, as Funker is highlighting here, to be able to really start spotting that. It's very, very difficult to spot because of the rock positionings, etc. So now we're going to see San try and go in there, and he's going to try and, you know, count pylons and things like that. But StarDust went for... Is that a really quick third pylon by the looks of things?
It's out there nice and early. The thing is with San is he hasn't really had a proper look around to see if there's a third pylon or not. If you think about San's pylon, it's just now being built. It could have been at the back there. It could have been on the right-hand side. So I'm not sure exactly if he's reading into this that there is a pylon missing. But whatever the case, maybe he is, maybe he's not. But he is sending the mothership core down left here. And if he crosses
San
pathways into this, he's going to spot the Stargate immediately. And what he shouldn't do is reveal the mothership core.
Yeah.
Bait him.
Uh-oh. Well.
San.
Wow. Oh, he reveals it.
He's going to try and go for the pylon here. He's not going to be able to get the pylon in time. And he should have just backed off immediately, as you can see.
Yeah, especially because now he's actually going for a Phoenix instead of anything. So that mothership core is in trouble. Doesn't have energy for a recall. Would end up dying pretty fast if that were to come along. So he'd have to reinforce.
Yeah, it's about 10 energy away. It might just have enough for recall, but it would definitely take damage here.
Yeah. But then it wouldn't have a Photon Overcharge later
on. Luckily for San, he's going to be the aggressor here. He's got Blink on the way. He's got a probe out in the middle of that, which has been spotted too. That's really big for this game. His probe's actually cut off, and he gets a pylon down, but he does see that. But of course, with that probe being alive, he would have liked to have got that a lot closer in, because then he could have launched his 3-gateway Blink attack much easier here.
Yeah, it's a good spot there from StarDust in the end, being able to deny that just a little bit. He does see everything in terms of the setup from San over the other side, so at least he knows that it's a Twilight Council with 3 gateways. So maybe he'll be able to prepare himself with that Robo of Silty on the way.
Yeah, he's got the Robo in straight away before additional gateways. You don't want extra units to defend against a Blink attack. You want to be going over straight towards the robotics facility because you need a multiple production immediately. That's the key unit that can, you know, defend against the type of Stalker attacks that we'll see, especially with Photon Overcharge, which will buy you enough time to get at least 2 Immortals out.
All right. Phoenix, once again, going to dive in, have a look around, maybe try to find the Mothership Core, tickle it a little bit, but does not find the room to. San's covering himself quite nicely, still Chrono Boosting into that Blink. Very important. The Stalkers were already piling on some pressure. Energy for a Photon Overcharge, though, should be able to keep this at bay.
And notice how he didn't use it straight away, because he doesn't want to waste time or energy on this if the Stalkers are just going to run away anyway, which they were going to do. So, but good confirmation with the Phoenixes. He double-checked the Twilight Council to see if Blink was still on the way, which is very smart for him there, because he knows it wasn't a cancel or something that's kind of a little bit funky. Just knows it is definitely Blink I'm playing against, and he's definitely just going to slow down his game a little bit here to make sure that he has the units out. The Immortal, obviously, the key unit here in defending and getting an expansion down ASAP. Yeah.
And Blink, in essence, also gives him the reassurance to go over now to that left-hand side and start killing that, because he has an escape route for this Stalker, just in case it were to get in a little bit of trouble through all of this. So this is also a nice move by Sand. It's small, but it will allow him to eventually... Oh, but there's three Phoenix on the way, so they could start picking up some of these units. That's a bit annoying for him.
Yeah, he could. But, I mean, if he picks off three Stalkers, sure, that hurts an attack, which I think he's going to be ready for anyway. So I would prefer if he can try to find some economic damage, Mothership Core damage, Probe damage. And his Nexus is coming in anyway. And the game is going to stabilize after this point. They both will get their expansion down. No one's committing to any sort of attack. And we will go into the next part of the game. Hence the Forge coming in for StarDust, looking to upgrade his units now. And to be honest, unless San has something crazy planned, he should be doing the same.
Nice pickup here by StarDust, quite literally, to be able to kill off a few of these Stalkers and then fall back from here on out. San, with quite a few Stalkers in essence, StarDust realizing that he had to fall back, otherwise those reinforcing Stalkers would have done some damage.
So as much as it was identified that he's playing against Stargate play, these Phoenixes are worth their weight in gold. They have so much potential value in them. They're scouting units, which means you don't have to think about getting a sentry too fast or wasting energy on hallucinated Phoenixes. You've got these stick out for you. You can catch loose probes. It's hard for Sand to be aggressive against a player who's in your face and scouting you all the time. These Phoenixes are so important in this game, and actually really nice, because if you think about the setup for both of them, they're kind of similar. If you think, you know, they've got the Nexus down, they've got the Forges coming in, one a little bit faster than the other, one's got the, you know, Immortals production coming in, but these Phoenixes are just something that Sand doesn't have.
And he's doing something so nice with his Phoenix, which is spreading them out, then converging on a single point to scout out everything on his side of the map. So if there were a probe on that side, he would have been able to find it and then pick it up. A very, very clever little move there by StarDust. So now he knows on his side of the map for now, there really isn't there to threaten him.
Really good observer placement, though. He's going to spot these three Phoenixes immediately, so he should be in position. He should be able to pounce on these and hopefully get one of these Phoenixes. Remember, Sand does have Blink. When is he going to pounce? There it is! And he is going to get one of them.
Lovely to shut down at least just one of those Phoenix for now, and he also can, you know, try and keep them off him and keep them at bay for quite a while. But now the Robo Bay is finished for StarDust, is being added on for San as well. So we're going to see a very, very similar composition out of these guys for now.
But it is StarDust who is in the lead with everything, just because he's got things faster. You know, he's got the plus one attack, he's got a slight few probes advantage, he's got the Colossus out faster, he's going to be able to just work on things a little bit easier because he has three Immortals out. And in this position, there's no need for him to do anything, because the player who's in the lead through the way that this has worked out with the Phoenix play and just how the early game went, it's up to Sand to make the key decisions on how he is going to find himself back in this game. Maybe it's through a little bit of harassment here and there with these Stalkers. Maybe it's taking a faster third base. Maybe it's trying to do this, trying to do that. But we really have to see how Sand's going to get himself back into an equal standpoint. One thing that I noticed throughout all of the WCS this season, Sand's mechanics, as Todd has mentioned, is almost second to none. He doesn't really make mistakes. So if StarDust makes mistakes, Sand will catch up. But fast third base, spotted immediately here.
Yeah, and so we'll see what StarDust wants to do against that. If he doesn't like go for some kind of push, he will just fall back onto his own third base. Yeah. Looks like that's what he's going to do, but it's a good point that you mentioned before, because San's engagement control as well throughout this entire season has been really, really strong, especially in Protoss versus Protoss. His form in PvP is a lot better than StarDust's in 2014. The numbers are very, very heavily in San's favor when it comes to this matchup as of late.
All right, well, I like that the third is coming in for StarDust, because as much as it would have been nice for him to be aggressive, it's also a risk. Do you risk to win the game there and then? Or do you say, okay, if you third, I'll third, and I'll continue and ride my advantage through. Nothing's actually changed in this game. We both will do the same thing from this point. So I like that decision from him. We do see faster four gateways coming in for San. But where are StarDust gateways? He actually needs to be adding on more gateways soon, because he's still, if you think about his entire setup, only on three gateways.
Yeah.
That's not good defensively or aggressively. It's something he should be adding on before his third Nexus completes.
Definitely. One advantage San did have going into these stages of the game is that, yes, he did have Twilight Council a little bit earlier, and thus he had Blink, and technically can start charge a little bit quicker, as StarDust was kind of putting all of his expenditure to other things or whatever. But for now, StarDust still leading in terms of supply, and San's just trying to pick off pylons where he can. Very, very I would say, relatively even game here so far in the start of it, but for now, StarDust has that little slight advantage.
Yeah, I mean, if you just look at the army, it's just like one extra Immortal, one extra Colossus shortly, and just a little bit of a faster upgrade and stuff like this. And overall, the numbers here you can see on your screen makes it a little bit easier for you to understand. But we'll see where this is going to go from here on out. We do have Stalkers still roaming around, blocking scouting information, which is always good, as you said, picking up pylons and so on. But no clean decision from either player as where they're looking to go or strike. They're not adding on excessive amounts of units. There's no wild tech swing. Temporal Archives at the right time here as the gases have been added on the third base to add in the Archons. But here for the first time, for a little bit here, is a deviation between the both of them. Mm. And it's San going for the Dark Shrine here. So if he's able to get Warp Prism out, potentially, a pylon somewhere around, he's going to be able to land some critical damage into the economy lines if there's not some sufficient enough defense.
And StarDust notices that his opponent did have his Templar Archives down a little bit quicker than him, so that's very important as well here. But in the grand scheme of things, I'm not anticipating big, big conflicts before we hit that 200 mark, because they feel really well set up on either side.
And notice how the Dark Shrine got scouted immediately and was forced into a cancel immediately. Mm, so the deviation is now gone. And now we continue back to where we just were a few seconds ago with a second robotics facility coming in, plus three apiece. We notice, though, how the hell Hassan got ahead in the lead with upgrades? Like, there's been nothing that's really slowed either of them down. He's just been hitting it faster, hitting the Chrono Boost into it, and he's pushed himself in a lead in that regard, which is rather nice for him. And it's small things like this that can allow San to slowly crawl back in, despite no action happening for the last little bit.
Yeah, of course, a slight advantage in terms of army supply for StarDust, but say, for example, both of them hit 200-200, and that plus three was had that small window opening, then San could do a lot of damage. The plus three weapons is so, so important in a matchup like this. Why you don't really see armor too much, because Colossi benefits so much from the weapons upgrades.
But the problem is I mean, remember that a lot of StarDust has a bigger army and a better army, but there's also Stalkers in San's army that aren't that useful either. I mean, what are Stalkers going to do in that jump in, get fried immediately and die?
True.
I mean, what are they really going to do? So they need to try to find a bit of value in this game still, maybe jump into the main base somewhere, try something along those lines. But one thing to note is that StarDust did see that fourth base being placed down. He knows he has the better army. He knows he's had the advantage for the majority of the game. So we'll see if he wants to try to look towards an attack soon.
Ooh.
But this armies are so similar that I don't think, even though it's slightly better for StarDust, the slightly better army he has is big enough to capitalize on an advantageous position, which San should always have, being the defending player, unless somehow he's caught out of that position. Zealots on this right-hand side could draw that out-of-position scenario with StarDust's main army on the left-hand side.
Yeah, that's he does see it all moving as well with that Observer, so he has to be careful about that. Colossi are going to do a little bit of poking around there, still sees it coming back, so he can easily retreat. It's a small little bit of damage that he did with the denial of the gas, but anything you can get in this position when they're both so even is good.
Yeah, definitely, definitely. But Dark Shrine coming in for StarDust now. We see a second Forge coming in for San.
Whoa.
So he's getting shield upgrades now, and he's also going to be focused on armor upgrades. So overall, he's just going to be looking really sick when it comes to his upgrades, and he's going to dedicate quite a bit of resources to that. We've seen a little bit of harassment attempts by both sides, Zealots here and there, but nothing really has been established with the harassment. I guess StarDust got a little bit with killing the Assimilator on that natural and a little bit of probe kills on this fourth base over here.
Yeah, it's interesting how things... I mean, San is really gearing up for that very, very long game, so he is happy to sit around. He knows he was in a little bit of a disadvantageous position in terms of where they were working things out, but now, with all of those upgrades coming along, it's very, very powerful. And the shields transition not only from Archons nicely, but if eventually Stargates become an issue with Tempests, etc., it helps out there as well.
And I like how the Phoenixes have been destroyed there as well, just to free up some extra supply here for StarDust. But the way that the Protoss armies work, because they're so slowish and sluggish but so powerful, is you need to find a way to pull your opponent out of position. And if you can, then because of the sluggish and slowish Protoss army, he's not going to be able to get back in time. So at this point of the game, Warp Prisms do become very valuable, which is why we see the Warp Prisms be Gravatic Drive Beam research here for San. If he can squeeze out a Warp Prism somehow, get his opponent out of position, he could find a way to take a good and convincing fight.
Yes, he could. That was a nice pickup on that right-hand side, but at the same time, a small bit of Zealot harassment in this mineral line. He warps in enough to be able to clean it up, though, so that's okay, too. Very, very level pegging right now. You're right with the Gravatic Drive, though. I would love to see maybe a little bit of a dart in, do some damage in those mineral lines, but yeah. Cannon's already being added on here.
Dark Templar, no cannon, they're late oh. here coming in, so we're actually all going to see these Dark Templar do something for Stardust. He's going to get a bit of damage done, and this is good. This is really good. This is actually a move that is gaining more than it's losing for the first time that we've really seen through all of them. It's mostly been army movements, feeling each other out, and just kind of scouting around.
Could lure him out of position as well if he goes with his main army. He was spotted,
though. If he gets that fourth, the whole army of Sands on the natural. This is a golden opportunity at the moment.
Yeah, he moved with it because the observer he thought he had was in the army, so he had to move with it.
Slow tank.
This is really, really
bad
for him.
If he snipes this Nexus and then just recalls out or something, but then again, you've got to... He's going to get it.
He's going to get it. There's no way. He can't save it. He actually pulls all the probes away. Great move by Stardust to start off this game, truly.
Yeah. And that's a big move.
Yeah.
That's the biggest move of the game now, really. And again, another big warping on this left-hand side. Going to be aiming for the cannons here. There is an observer in there, which is kind of nice to help out against the Dark Temple. Multiple observers, actually. But a really good move. Forcing a big recall. That slow, sluggish, mammoth-type army has to come back to defend. But that's a big win for Stardust. Really limited his opponent's income, and look at the money. Look at the money to the top right.
It's banking up. It's banking up for Stardust dramatically because he is basically almost maxed out at this point and can just keep churning that out. And he has the better income as well because this base did go down. Now it's going to have to be re-established for San. He is supply blocker, and this mothership being added on for Stardust as well. So his army is going to become extremely powerful.
He's going to turn him invisible. And unfortunately for Stardust, I mean for San, you know, he dedicated to those double forge. He hasn't really been able to use them correctly yet. He's only now just been able to go into the 2-2 of both of these upgrades, which should have been early because they both did complete earlier, but they're very expensive upgrades trying to go for the shield. So unfortunately for him, it's harder to make that work with this Nexus being killed off.
He's actually killing his own Archon in his mineral line because it's stuck, his San. So that just dies there behind all that pylon and stuff. So, but he has, you know, with that fourth base being reestablished, he has the money to be able to fill that back. But every little is going to count because Stardust Bank is so, so big, so severe in comparison.
And the mothership core difference between the two of them is so large as well. That's really something to think about here.
San now looking for some harassment on this right-hand side of this natural base. Blinking forward, going to try and get up into the main, but there is a Dark Templar there, which eventually will clean things up considering there's no observer, but still.
Yeah.
Oh, if you could get the warp prism, that would be nice, but doesn't get it in the end.
No, but imagine a fight here with Stardust, who does have observers with his own army.
Getting an upgrade, that's a big deal.
Yeah, look at the fight. I think the fight's the most important part right now. This army is so good from Stardust. The mothership core trailing behind. He's got units with his army that can pick off his opponent's observer, then it's basically an invincible army. It can't be seen.
I wonder if he even knows there's a proper mothership with that, but yeah, he has to be very, very careful about how he's doing. This is basically one of the strongest Protoss armies you can get, aside from the addition of Tempest, which San is now going towards, but it's just Archon, Colossus, Immortal, basically. Yeah, it's very scary.
Yeah, there's great harassment going on here by San, but DT's Beam Warped in should be enough to help with that.
He's got to be careful. He's taking a lot of extra volleys there as he's trying to move this away, but now he sees that it's all cloaked up.
Oh, mothership caught an observer at the front there. Mothership core's gone, no time warp, so that's actually a little bit bad to, for him to use.
Time warps in Colossus versus Colossus is a big, big deal here, so he has to be careful with that. San's still going to work. It's actually Dark Templar versus Dark Templar. Drone on that may have been an engagement. There's the time warp there, though, from Stardust, slowing that down at the front. Also, he has a better concave. Some of the Colossus out fire on the left-hand side, while San's are, but Stardust is going up in terms of supply from here on out. That time warp helped him out a lot, and it's all invisible still.
He caught the unit. San moved out, and he got caught with the time warp, which is the disadvantage through not having a mothership core. And now Stardust is going for it. He's got the mothership core. And most importantly, he's got the money. He's got 5,000 minerals, 2,000 gas. He can just keep on going. Keep on warping in. Hammer this one home. Get the first map. Get the momentum in your favor. And if he starts this series with this victory, you know Stardust loves a bit of momentum on his side. And he'd carry that through to the next game as well.
Stardust was killing a few probes off there with his cannons to try and bulk up this army even more. So very, very tense PvP here. San is down so far in terms of supply and doesn't really have the bank to currently compete with Stardust. He is running away with this. Unless San does something, he's going to be dead.
And Stardust says, yo, bro, how big's your army, man? Because I'm on the right-hand side, I'm going to come from the left-hand side as well, and you're going to be forced to move your army one way or the other. And unfortunately for San, who is down in numbers, simply can't defend two areas effectively. And that is a very smart move from StarDust, who's looking to close this one out. The natural goes undefended. San's going to chase the army, maybe with a good victory, a good fight on that army. He could make this work, but it's going to be hard.
He's playing this out beautifully, and he actually funnels all of this army into this small choke. Archons go down very fast. Lots of San's Colossi aren't even firing at this point. This is a disaster position for San. There you go. GG. StarDust takes game number one. Wow. What a PvP to open up this series.
Great start. And remember, one of the most important parts for me watching that game, San in PvP games rarely loses in long, drawn-out macro games. If you think back to the games against MC, he won every single one of those games, and it looked quite easy as well. But StarDust says, you've got to do something to actually stop me in a heads-up game and a toe-to-toe fight. I am good enough to win this championship here today. I am good enough for that $25,000 first place prize, the 2,000 WCS points to his name, and of course, the right and the prestige to be a WCS European champion.
He's been aching for it for a long time, ever since his championship at DreamHack. His second proper premier title here would be fantastic for him. But now, game number two, we go on to Waystation, a map we don't see too often, more so in mirror matchups than anything. And this has the potential of once again being a very long PvP if they let it get that far.
Absolutely. Waystation can really play in a couple of ways depending on which spawns they land on. If it's the further away ones, we could see a longer drawn out game. If it's close, we could see quite an aggressive game come out from one of these guys.
But
so
also,
we'll see.
We've got to consider the fact that StarDust in this series has the potential to bust out that very aggressive play that he used against First in his previous match yesterday. So I'm under the impression we will see that during this series at some point. But when is the question? Maybe when he goes a map up, two maps up, when is that going to come out? And is or will San be ready for that kind of play?
That's right. There are a lot of different tactics, strategies that both players could use to gain an easier victory, but at the level of play that these both are playing at, it's going to be very hard to get that easy victory and try to stop this train from just going out of control, really. As StarDust, one game up, looking to get the second, and we'll see. Looking very composed at the moment, and all that both of them are saying in the chat lobby, if you guys obviously can't see, is go. That's all they're saying is go, good luck, let's go, let's do this, and it shall begin.
All right, countdown has begun for game number two now. San, he won that Asus ROG, but a WCS title for him would mean so much as well. He's been on the verge, on the cusp, really, of properly breaking through in the European scene time and time again. So many top eight finishes. He would love to take this title home with him. All right, let's get into it. Game number two, San versus StarDust. Our finalists here. So high in terms of ranking. San is looking for number one in the world. StarDust is looking to be number three in the world at this point. Down at the bottom right, we have our red Protoss representing my insanity. It's StarDust! I think we have a fan favorite. And up to the top left-hand corner, our blue Protoss, representing Yo Flash Wolves, it's San!
Okay, so cross positions here. More difficult to pull off those fast gateway attacks, three gateway attacks, anything like this is hard to make work. And we could be seeing a longer drawn-out game here. We'll see if we've got some special tactics and strategies that are going to be brought to the game. We see San scouting inside his main base, wary of a potential proxy inside already. More difficult to pull off, but even though it's slower and less effective, sometimes it's more effective because the opponent is just completely writing that off from happening, which Sometimes can be the case.
Yeah. It takes a probe to a long, long time to get over there if you're going to try it on this map. That's for sure. But for now on, it's just going to be the same builds here. Double gases. Interesting to see how many are going to be in each gas, of course.
Stardust sending out an early probe here. And it's going to scout around the natural and is actually on the way to the other side of the map. So two things. It can obviously just be to get inside Sand's base immediately to have a feel out, double gas there or not, pylons there or not. Or he could be trying something to hide further on the left or the right. But at the moment, it is heading towards that main base.
Yeah, it could be going for deviation.
Uh-oh.
I think it's going to be the same.
It could be the same.
Yeah.
Very well could be the same. Depends how far left he goes. I think it's not going to be the same now. If he'd gone up towards the natural area and put the Stargate up there, I think this could be for a Twilight Council. It could be for Dark Templar to be hidden.
Alternatively, one argument towards Stargate would be because the Mothership Core scouted it out so well in the previous game, he would be putting it really far away, so that would never happen. But that is
Oh, and look at this. Double probe. Look at that mind game. Yeah. Sends out a probe later, at the later but normal time for a lot of players to move out with, to fake it even more. Stargate is going to be the choice here from him. But so, nice fake with the double probe.
Yeah, definitely. So I think, you know, what we were mentioning before, the idea of the Mothership Core coming out and spotting it, it kind of comes to fruition. I mean, Stardust, though, just trying to chase this away. Noticeably, you know, he shows the Mothership Core coming out at that particular time. He didn't go for the Stargate, the Mothership Core. So, it creates the illusion what like the gas has gone into that for now.
Yeah. That's actually really good, actually. San, I think, knows that there could be a proxy out on the map. Look how he's looking and searching around. Yeah. Because when you enter the main base of a Protoss player, if they're not proxying anything, if they're not rushing out a structure, they have... Okay, so simply for anyone that's learning, when the Cyber Core completes and you've mined from 3 and 3 in each assimilator, you get 250 gas, right? So if you get 250 gas, why is only 100 being spent on the Mothership Core on the Nexus? Why is Warpgate Research not being researched? And why isn't Stalkers being built? If you get those, you start to spend that gas, right? Or
that's
a sentry. So if he goes in and only sees the Mothership Core being built, then where's that gas gone? He's not delaying it on purpose for a mind game. So San's really thinking and reading into this very nicely. And I think he suspects a proxy, even though he's seen absolutely nothing.
Yeah, he's scouting out everywhere for it. You're right. So very, very good analysis of this situation. San, for now, is unfortunately for him, he's not going to be able to find it anytime soon. The Oracle is already on the way, but he's already got Stalkers and his Mothership Core positioned to be able to greet such eventualities.
Yeah, I mean, he's playing this perfectly. He's having a look around. Ooh. He's going to spot the Oracle.
Nice.
Perfect. This is really good game sense from San. Really, really good. He's got his units in position. He's got a Photon Overcharge if he wants to use it if this Oracle commits. Great defense, you know. And that was all without even seeing the Stargate. That was actually really, really nice.
Very, very well done. Two extra gateways. Wait. Three? Okay. Yeah, two extra gateways and a Robo Facility being added on behind this for Stardust, knowing that he hasn't really done too much with the Oracle, but it could always pose a threat later.
San's gonna go for a counter here. So he knows his opponent spent a lot of resources in that, and he knows, obviously, he doesn't have Blink or anything along the line. So San's going to go for craziness. Oh. He's got the Mothership Core back at home to make sure the Photon Overcharge is there and use if the Oracle goes in, and he's now going to test what Stardust defense is. That's a lot of resources which have gained zero value, and even more money being thrown into it with a second Oracle. That means the defense of Stardust is very limited right now. Sure, he has a Photon Overcharge, but that's it. That's really all he has right now until that Robo finishes up properly.
Exactly. It's pretty, late in comparison to what we're actually seeing in terms of the build here from Stardust. So he's not really going to have an Immortal out super, super fast. He needs to Chrono Boost into that right now.
Yeah.
He knows it's a threat. He knows the threat is here and is real. These Stalkers are going to start working on things and blinking back, saving themselves.
Look at that. That's brilliant because he knows he's got to wait till the Photon Overcharge goes down. So he actually wastes a bit of shield damage to bring down that pylon, putting so much pressure on. He throws an expansion behind this as well. Things are going really good so far for San. And at the moment, with the unit count that Stardust has, and Photon Overcharge going down in seconds time here.
Loses a sentry. Guardian Shield was up on that, so it won't be able to deny any damage on this. The Immortal has popped, though. But still really good blink control by San.
Yeah.
Really turning on the heat here in game number two.
And he's not overcommitting to a huge amount of Stalkers here, because he could. He could try to jump on the Immortal, but that gives an opportunity for a mistake to happen and Stardust to capitalize. He's got Stalkers. He's pressuring. He's going to force the second Photon Overcharge. He's killed three pylons, including that one there, and he's got the sentry to force field him in.
Photon Overcharge being forced here as those two Oracles and two Zealots, most importantly, actually get warped in to try and help this out. But the two Zealots also warped in for Sam to defend. Very, very important. Oh. But there's quite a few probes.
This is a bulldozing move here coming out from Stardust. He just throws it in. Getting 11 kills there. That's really, really good. Really good. I didn't expect that to work, but a big bulldoze move. He finally finds a Stargate.
But does that negate the fact that this Nexus is already very, very quick here for San? I think that he can replenish those probes pretty fast.
Right now, he needs to be chronoboosting into the probes and also chronoboosting into the Immortal, too, to get his own Immortal out by buying as much time as possible with the Sentry. It's a sacrificial Sentry on the other side. But look at this. To skip over the Force Field, we have the Warp Prism. And this is a nice move here. He's going to obviously just drop these down on top of this army. Great move here from Stardust. And the Force Field completely useless. And San's going to have to blinkety-blunk all the way home now.
Poor Sentry doesn't have blink. He gets left home. A sad little guy. But for now, Stardust starts up his Nexus. It's very, very slow in comparison, though. He's going to go and take a third Nexus. He's going to go to the island. He knows he's in a lot of trouble in terms of speed, so he has to do something drastic. This is going to be that move. Whoa. But San, where is that Observer going? He's going to... No. Oh, my God.
No. He shouldn't see it. I think it's just that side vision
range. No, I think with air vision...
Well, the Nexus is even... Oh, he's checking. No way.
Oh, my God. No, wait. I don't think he noticed.
No, he just checked if the Nexus was there.
Wow. Oh, my God. If San doesn't end up punishing this somehow eventually, double Stargate? Okay. What is going on?
I think he may have seen the probe. I'm not sure.
You think?
I don't know. Funky, did he see the probe?
I don't think he did. Shake... Yes, no?
He doesn't know.
No, he doesn't know.
I don't know what that means.
That was the weirdest
thing. I don't speak Observer.
Don't know.
Yeah, I don't speak Observer talk.
All right, that
but
was...
But this is... I mean, either way, he's going for this double Stargate here. I'm not too sure if he knows about this potential up there.
I don't think
but
so.
But even if he doesn't, and I don't think he does, because this double Stargate is going to be pretty intense no matter what.
Oh,
because
yes.
This is not going to be scouted.
Very intense.
This is not going to be scouted easily. Whether it be Void Ray or Phoenixes, it doesn't matter because they just are going to destroy everything.
Yeah.
Void Rays will just charge through everything. Phoenixes are going to pick up everything.
I mean, he's trying to scout out the bottom left island base. Doesn't see anything there. So that gives me the indication that he didn't see it up to the top right. Because why would you be checking the bottom left if it was up at the top right? Stardust did see the probe at the third base chilling out just a little bit ago. So he's anticipating the fact that a third is going to come down soon, but knows it isn't there just yet.
Yeah, this is definitely an interesting one. I do like Stardust's decision to try this
Phoenix.
Third. You know, I really do like that. These Phoenixes are going to run havoc in this game. There's simply no answer to them yet.
Yeah. Dark Shrine of the Island as well. Yeah. Oh my God, Stardust, you crazy man.
Dark Shrine could do a lot actually.
Look how close this is. Yeah. Hop, skip, and a jump over there, and you find an entire base, my friend. You make one Void Ray and happy times.
Depending on which way he flies with the Phoenixes, he may cross paths with the pylon.
True.
It's close, but he's edging slightly more to the left now, so... Yeah, no.
Wow, he doesn't know it's that at all.
All right, but this is still going to be a big surprise. This is actually going to do considerable amounts of damage, too.
Yeah. Because the lack of the anti-air, it could actually go in there, pick up all the sentries, kill those off super fast. There's only two Stalkers, really, to be able to deal with that.
Yeah.
And he will start picking things up and actually killing them off, but two Phoenix worth of DPS isn't too much. So he doesn't want to pick up three units at a time.
Yeah, he shouldn't have picked the Immortal up. Should have just got the sentries. That was a bit of a mistake.
All right, plus two weapons actually on the way for Stardust, so he is ahead in terms of those upgrades, and the two Dark Templars are now warping in for during all of this.
There is an Observer inside the main base, though.
Okay. So he should be all right.
So, yeah, he should be all right, but he doesn't really have many units there, which is the bigger problem. They split up, too, and there's one Observer to cover two locations, remember?
Everything was invested into those Stargates.
Yeah, this is going to do a bit of damage.
All right, so nice move here by Stardust to really kind of get himself back into this. It was looking perilous for him just before, about 5 or 10 minutes ago, but now... He's doing all right with these Dark Templars, really evening things up, and that third base still not noticed is doing work for him.
Yeah, he killed an extra 7 probes there, so that was actually rather good from those Dark Templar, and he gets out with one of them and can live to fight another day. But these Phoenixes need to start doing some work here for San.
All right, Warp Prism, gauged and ready to go, but he's going to have to evade all of these Phoenix eventually. He's actually splitting up. The one Phoenix is down to the left-hand side. Maybe he's banking on the fact that a Warp Prism is out somewhere. So I was trying to look for that somewhere.
Yeah, he saw the warp prism. He knows it's somewhere, but just doesn't know where exactly. Plus two coming in for both players now. Much, much faster here for StarDust.
Those Phoenix are going to the top right. They are going to the top right, and they are going to find that base. And cannons have been added on. So he now finds it.
Yeah, well done, Sen. And he's going to kill those probes.
And to be honest, it hasn't really paid for itself at all right now. It was going to take a long time for it to pay for itself.
You got a little bit of extra gas, but not too much.
Yeah, and Darkshrine did get a few kills, so you could factor that in as well.
StarDust has to be very careful of any movement out he makes. As you know, he's got four hefty immortals, but any movement out is going to be actually dangerous because of the Phoenixes here. They're going to do a lot of pickups, and there's a good amount of units out here for Sen. He's got Zealot Charge, my favorite upgrade. He's got a lot of gateways coming in too, and his overall just building up a big, big army. As you can see, the supplies are taken away a little bit. And without an effective mining third from StarDust, and there is one for Sen, it's quite easy to call who's in the lead at the moment. Look how many probes are even on the natural.
That's because he just recalled a load of them over to the third base with the Mothership Core. But interestingly enough, the way the Phoenix work in this Syngate, once it comes, is there's seven Phoenix out right now against five Immortals. If he actually picks up all of those Immortals and just negates them for the first 10 seconds or so of that fight, it becomes a real pain in the neck for StarDust.
He does see that a lot of probes are up there now, and they must have been recalled, so it's not a bad as a position that StarDust could have been in with those probes mining up there. Warp Prism down south for Sen, and while he moves out in the middle, and he is going to drop inside the main base while putting a bit of pressure on at the same time through the middle. StarDust may encounter the Protoss army. Does see it slightly.
Got to be careful with that Dark Templar, wants to run away. Is there even an observer with the army, though? He's with the Mothership Core. So that's quite a strong army.
He's got a very strong army. And like I said, the lifts are going to be so cool here.
Yeah.
Picking up those Immortals, you have to target down the Phoenixes. You've got to get rid of the Phoenixes. You need your Immortals in this fight.
It's a really
big
deal.
There are so many Zealots here. There's, you know, more gateways currently for Sen. He's a little bit pylon bot, which is really crappy. But the army that he has outside StarDust, he's going to be able to deliver a good fight and potentially, with a good fight, equal this up. StarDust doesn't know this is happening yet. Hallucinate Finish is going to show him. He's got to get ready now.
It's right on his doorstep. How well is he going to be able to deal with this? Photon Overcharge goes down. The Phoenix poke in to assess the situation. There is a High Templar there that could actually do a lot of damage to those Phoenix very fast. That is a good counter to those in this situation.
If StarDust holds on and gets effective damage with his Warp Prism on the natural here, a big warp in of Zealot DTs, get rid of the cannons and do good damage to the economy lines, great.
Nice find. Very, very nice find. Nice start for him during this.
He's going in.
All right. Going to try and push on forwards here. The Phoenix aren't in this fight. The Immortals actually behind that Assimilator are in a really good position for defense.
Look at that. Wow. The two gateways at the front there, the good position. But at the same time, we have a Warp Prism from Sen getting into the main base. This is going to hurt a lot more, and it may offer another opportunity to Sen to go in again.
Very, very close here. The Phoenix actually fly in. He could actually pick some of those off, but doesn't get them too much. And Zealot still actually doing a lot of damage in the main base.
StarDust has +3 as well, remember.
Gateway's holding their own at the front of this as they're trying to hold on against
Sen
all of that.
Sen can't break him. He can't break through that. The heavy Zealot kind of play isn't working because of all these structures and the Immortals and Archons behind the structures. Great defense. Really, really clever and nice clinical play from StarDust.
Very good. So back and forth this second game. Sen behind all of that took a fourth base.
Yeah, but
it's
not working. He can't kill him, so he's had to retreat back to a fourth. There is an opportunity, though. The cannon's on the natural. The cannon's on the natural here. If they get picked off, the DTs should not be at the front here. The Zealots need to get rid of them, and then the DTs will do the rest.
All right. If that one Dark Templar can stay alive, he can do quite a lot, you're right. But we have the army once again moving through. He sees the fourth base. There is a cannon there, try and hold on out. He does recall to save this base. Very important for him. But StarDust, this gives him more time to breathe, more time to just establish good defense and, you know, get that economy continuing on throughout those three bases.
Yeah, what a great series and good game this one. Really back and forth. Yeah. Some interesting strategies, some good thought processes being thrown in by both players here. And overall, just good strategy and good StarCraft, apart from that one gateway which blocked his units in. But we'll forget about that one. StarDust will give you a freebie there. Yeah. But look at the supplies now. StarDust efficiently mining on these three bases has built a massive army. Look at that.
And he negated the Phoenix so well before. There were seven before, now there's only four. It's not going to be as easy to get lifts off because those High Templars are in there with the ability to feed back and really negate that, the negation, as weird as that sentence sounds, during everything that goes on.
Yeah, it's time for StarDust to take a fourth. He can start to be a little bit aggressive himself. And now all of a sudden, Sanu threw a lot of money into that attack before, has now found himself, after not being able to crack his opponent, in an interesting position as we do see StarDust slightly ahead. But the army, there's a lot of Zealots in this, but look how many Archons there are for Sand. So as much as the numbers are in favor of StarDust, 9 Archons. We'll see. There's so many Immortals that are going to play a massive play, a massive part of this fight. But again, position in favor of Sand. StarDust army. He's got low probes, high army count, remember.
Dropping the main as well.
145 army supply. It's huge.
Uh-oh. There's actually no Observer in the main base anymore. He's trying to credit boost one out here. It's StarDust.
Look at the storms in this little choke area.
Got to be so careful about your army positioning. That's a lot of Zealots to be able to tank here for StarDust. He's so up in terms of supply. He's going to be able to break down that Nexus very fast. A good storm actually catches a lot of those Archons as well as the Immortals. Shreds off the shields from those Immortals very, very clinically and does pull after getting the Nexus.
Yeah, he gets the Nexus, but the Nexus doesn't really need to be saved as much. I mean, in terms of income, they're not that much different between them, but definitely the army is so big for StarDust. The 145 supply, it's actually huge at this point.
Where's the Observer? Okay, so the Observer's in the main mineral, the natural mineral line, really not helping out against those Dark Templars in the main.
Yeah, this army's not going to be beaten. This army's not going to... Look at it. Look at the size of it.
It's huge.
These Phoenixes aren't doing anything in assistance anymore. They were meant to be used earlier, which they weren't.
It's 147 supply against 106 in terms of this army. It's absolutely massive. I don't know how he can beat... I mean, yeah, Archons are pretty good, but they're not good enough to be able to defeat so many Immortals
in
that army.
Phoenixes go in. They just die instantly.
Nice feedback to be able to deny any lifts on those Immortals. Very, very important during this. The two Colossi at the back getting a lot of work done here for San, but StarDust's numbers just overwhelm him through this, push him back, and he's going to continue the chase.
StarDust is on fire right now. He's absolutely playing some of the best StarCraft he's played in ages. This is some really good PvP. He said earlier on in an interview he was feeling a little bit unconfident when it came to his Protoss versus Protoss recently, but he's delivering some world-class games currently, and he's looking in fantastic position to go up 2-0 in the grand finals here. He's looking for the finishing move. He's played this one out so good. I thought he was going to die, but he managed to survive on that natural. He was playing from a difficult position at the start of the game here.
Yeah.
He was thinking, he was making the right decisions at the right time, and now he's looking to end this one.
You're right. It was been an amazing performance here in game number two for StarDust for the recovery. Now looking to push away this final remaining force of Sand. Very little left. The Colossi have nowhere to go. Storms as well as the Zealots just pushing on forwards to end the final blow to this army with the Immortals staying true to their name, staying alive at the back of this force. Warp Prism reinforces as well into the mineral line with those elves. GG, game number two goes to StarDust. What a performance so far in these two games. And you were saying he didn't feel too confident before, but this surely has to give him a bit going into this next couple.
Yeah, he's looking good, and at the moment he's on the road towards winning this championship, and San needs to really buckle down and figure out a way to stop this guy. Otherwise, this could be a landslide. And we saw earlier on with San versus Golden, he feels the pressure when he's in a behind situation. He feels the pressure. He did well in that series, though, to recover and stay strong to who he is. But right now, this is a very difficult task. And to be honest, one of the most difficult tasks that Sans had to face recently.
Yeah, true as anything. Golden was quite the task before in the previous series. Normally, Sans looks absolutely formidable against Zergs, but here now against StarDust, it's looking shaky. He had the advantage in that game, quite clearly had the advantage in the second game, but it was stolen away from him by StarDust. Quick thinking, quick to that third base.
Yeah.
Kept it hidden for a while.
And it's really hot in here, of course. StarDust asking for some more. You can see him sweating in this kind of intense atmosphere. He's even got shorts on, but that's not helping him here. The lights, the studio, the atmosphere, the temperature in here, and of course the intensity of playing a grand final against, you know, one of the best. One of the best. These are the two finest Protoss, really, I think we can say, with MC that we have in the Europe region, and they are head-to-head challenging for the $25,000 first place prize. It's massive. $15,000 guaranteed for both. That's a good payoff for their hard work this season. But an extra $10,000 would go to the winner here. And of course, almost the security of being able to play at the global finals. Winning this,
it's a
lot of points, and you're starting to really secure your position. And with all and a lot more tournaments coming up, you've got some other global events coming up in the next week or so. Industry Masters Shenzhen happening, DreamHack Valencia is happening, so there's a lot more opportunities to grab those points. But right now, this is all that matters.
The atmosphere here in the studio is absolutely electric for this grand final. StarDust have been playing out of his mind these past two games. And you're right, those points really, really matter. Game number three now on the way between San and StarDust. Can San stop the bulldoze effect here of StarDust? As we have spawning up to the top right-hand corner, our red Protoss representing my insanity, it's StarDust. And spawning down to the bottom left-hand corner, we have our blue Protoss representing Yo Flash Wolves. It's San.
You know, StarDust has had a good run just in WCS overall, within the Premier League. He qualified from Challenger in Season 2 last year. He got 6th in Season 3 last year. Unfortunately, losing out to Vortex 3-1. He then came back the following season, which was this year in Season 1. Got top 8, lost to the Boss Toss, who then went on to get his championship. Mm. And he's come for a third attempt in Premier League and currently sitting in the finals, 2 games up versus San, who likewise has had a fantastic run within WCS. Of course, he got that 3rd to 4th place finish last season on his debut. And already, again, at least another semi-final. 2 times Premier League, 2 top 4 finishes. And then, of course, San outside of this. You know, he got top 4 at DreamHack Summer recently. He went over to Korea for the global championship that GSL held, representing the Europe region, got top 4 there as well. These players are absolutely fantastic and really representing the Europe scene well. And we have a lot of players within the top 16 in the ranking that are representing Europe well. We've got MC, Sands in there. StarDust, of course, is in there. You've got Jack G. And, of course, a couple of other players just outside the top 16, like 4GG. And then you've got the classics, Snoot and Well. The Europe region really, really strong and showing its presence out there.
Yeah, and it's important to know that global kind of championship that they had over in Korea, because San coming fourth in that when he was competing against some of Korea's best, that's a big deal. San can really hang with the absolute best of them, and it's really showing here that StarDust's Protoss versus Protoss right now is monstrous. Mm. So San needs to somehow find a way to be able to shut this down. Otherwise, he's going to get clean swept. StarDust is looking great.
He is looking absolutely fantastic here, and we'll see how this one's going to shape up. Both players did scout at the same time. As you can see, this kind of clockwork movement with the probes as they scout. They want to get inside their opponent's base to figure out what's going on. Information is so important in StarCraft, and we notice a lot of earlier probe scouts in PvP in the recent times to get that info. That you don't want to get a ship core comes out. You don't want to get a shutout before a Stalker's caught. You want to be able to get in there. Have a look. How much gas has been mined? Is it double gas? Is there a second gateway, for example? So, you know, it's good to get the probes in there. Both players do get that scout.
Yeah, very nice.
StarDust. Trying for extra scouting.
Oh, but will be spotted.
Yeah, should be spotted here. And unfortunately, his plan. Well, at least he gets the unit scout.
Yeah.
Which is something you don't get too often. And he sees the Twilight Council.
Oh, nice.
Woohoo! StarDust, that works in your favor. Well, any mind games coming in here by San? Cancel? Yeah. Mind games.
All right.
Hashtag mind games. So Twilight to Stargate.
Yeah. Okay, so StarDust is going to be, in essence, preparing for something that really isn't coming. That's Stargate being added on. But adds on the Nexus after the Twilight Council being spotted.
StarDust here. Yeah, he's thrown in a Nexus here. He was a little bit late on his Warpgate research. Quite late. He forgot it, Claris. He's 100 seconds behind, 80 seconds behind.
So that's not good.
He's actually chronoboosting into that. And to protect a Nexus, you obviously need your gateways on pretty fast here, especially if we were to see aggression.
Oh, spots the Nexus as well.
This is quite big. This is a big mistake.
StarDust, San, are you going to look to exploit this?
Yeah, he's chronoboosting into the Cybercore again to try and rush that out. Bit of a mistake there.
He's going to hit. He's going to hit, by the looks of things, timing that technically shouldn't be there if the warp gate was kind of there for StarDust.
Yeah, we'll see if it's going to play an impact. I think the biggest part is he's had to use chronoboost in there when he shouldn't have had to. Mm. It should be getting and saving up to get the Immortal out or something along those lines, but A scout here from StarDust sees a pylon aggressive there. Doesn't really know what that means. Is this Dark Temple here? Is he going to have to start to rush out and observe it pretty fast?
By the time that Hallucinated Phoenix gets over there, it's the Oracle's already going to be gone.
Oh, he misses the Oracle with his scout, by the way. Rushing out an observer, of course, because he doesn't know what this is exactly. Warpgate Research still being chrono-boosted into.
Sees the Stargate now, so maybe he'll be preparing a little bit more for that. But only sees the...
Four Stalkers, two Oracles. He can gun down the Sentry pretty fast here. Photon Overcharge is going to be forced out on this Natural Nexus shortly.
Yeah, Stardust has got to be very
But if he does
careful.
That, then he's got to be careful of the Oracle inside his main.
Stardust his own Stargate behind all of this as well.
Oh, the good defense.
Oracle sees that, though. But yeah, you're right. He does push that away.
San is... it's going to be hard to break this. I mean, he sees the Robo down. Photon Over... There's almost a second Photon Overcharge available. The first Mortal's coming in. It looks like, he whoops in two more Stalkers.
Yeah, I was going to say,
Why did he whoop in two more?
He's got a probe set up for Nexus position, but...
He might go for this.
Yeah.
It looks like he's going to try and go for this. You wouldn't whoop in two more Stalkers if you're going to expand there. You're just delaying your own Nexus, so this is interesting.
Did he just whoop in more?
And he's got the Phoenix coming out. That's obviously going to be, I would suggest, to pick up the Immortal, right? The Immortal's the big part of this army.
The Mothership Core's going home, which would have been nice for the assault, but...
Yeah, but if maybe an Oracle squeezes out to defend...
Yeah, it's true. It would be nice.
If he can get this...
It could do a lot of damage. He doesn't have a Sentry to be able to force field off the ramp, unfortunately for him, and the Immortal does pose a threat. Gotta be careful about how you do this. Another Photon Overcharge will buy him so much time. His Nexus is still very delayed, and he's still not made. He's just
after this, units. After this Photon Overcharge, he's going to go.
Yeah.
He'll wait for that, and then he'll fight most likely. I'm pretty sure that the Phoenix is here. Well, they have to pick up the Immortal. I would pick up the Immortal, and then just... That's it. And then if it gets killed, pick it up again with the other one, because I think he has two.
The Phoenix?
Yeah.
You're right.
Pick up the Immortal, man. That's the big damage dealer here. Get these sentries killing the Zealots and Sentry. Get the Oracles killing the Zealots and Sentries. No Photon Overcharge. It's only got about 20 seconds left.
Got to be careful here, Stardust. San, right now, in terms of army supply, is up slightly.
And then you're going to have the Immortal in the air, which is four of that army supply, remember? Here we go. Photon Overcharge is down. Pick up that Immortal. He's got to find a good position to fight, though.
Right. Certainly wants a good force field as well.
Three Phoenixes come out of nowhere.
Oh, trying to deal with those Phoenix themselves. That Nexus is taking a lot of damage, though. Force fields do actually hold a lot of that army off. Stardust, there's the double time warp here from San, bringing that Mothership Core back to try and aid in this fight. Army supplies are so close during all of this, but if he can't break the Nexus, then what can he do?
Well, we'll see. There's a lot of Stalkers left. He can't lose that Immortal.
Needs to keep that Immortal alive, but it's not going to be kept alive. The probe is actually pushing it to the front there as well. San still has an opportunity to do some damage.
He does, and San's going to break this, and it looks like we are going to see a retreat to the main base. The Mothership Core was killed for both players, and the Nexus shall fall, so a successful attack there may not have been the way he wanted to do it, but he does get that down, and that's good. From this position, he can start to maybe think about getting in a Sentry and force fielding here, maybe. He'll probably try and expand behind this. He does have the Twilight Council coming in as well, so he might go up towards Blink pretty fast.
Getting his own Nexus from here on, I think, is absolutely important. It's going to be difficult to really break that with what he has, and he does go for that Nexus there. So Phoenix for Stardust, though, head over, and they should be able to kill off that probe and then get the intel that they require, knowing now that, you know, him being Nexusless does spot that.
All right, so three Sentries and Immortal being built here, and Stardust needs to break down, and he needs to start thinking about expanding fast here. It's going to be very hard to do an attack. I guess there's no Mothership Core either for San, which is something he actually needs to start thinking about getting. Mothership Core, very important, but it should be just an expansion coming out here from Stardust. And this game shall move on.
Blink on the way for San, So Stardust trying to re-expand himself, knowing that he has lost a little bit during that. Nice pickup here for San if he's able to get any, but no, does not, as they scoot on out of there. And that Warp Prism trying to also sneak around as well. Very, very important. If he can get to the mineral line here of San once again, maybe he can try and bring himself back nicely in terms of that loss that happened before.
Well, at least one thing's in Stardust's favor. He's got the bigger units, the powerful units here. We have the double Phoenix, which I like described in game number one, very good at scouting, intel, and just being a bit of a nuisance, really. And then he's also got the second Immortal coming down quite fast. Forge and Twilight do start at the same time here for Stardust, as we do have Sam with his own. Stalker's a little bit out of position to stop that scout, but the game moves on to the next part, which is the mid-game. And I do favor slightly Sen's position. I always prefer the economy because even though you're behind on some other aspects, if you have a better source of income, obviously you can start to catch up slowly but surely.
Yeah, with plus one started as well for him, and we saw how things have developed in the previous games. If you know, he started as plus one quicker than Stardust now, and in the previous games he started him later but still caught up. One would assume that San from here could actually push those forwards very, very quickly and get a significant advantage if Stardust isn't careful. So he really needs to babysit that plus one, does Stardust, and make sure that it's on par with his opponents.
All right, so it becomes a game of information. Both players need to figure out their opponent's next move before it happens, because if you don't, you could get blindsided by something you're not too sure about. So a good denial of scout there. Really good. He's able to prevent San from getting more information, because the only thing he knows, I killed a Nexus, man.
Yeah.
I don't know anything else apart from killing a Nexus, so you don't know what the follow-up is. Is it a random Dark Shrine that could be happening? It could be anything. So it's really important to get information in, and we are going to see Stardust with an Oracle try to get further information here. He's already seen the Forge and the Robo. He's going to see the Robotics Bay, which is the most crucial part here. So he knows his opponent's going up towards Colossus. Notice how these Phoenixes are preventing any scout from coming in. And I wonder if he'll use this kind of cloud, this kind of smoke to his advantage here. Mm. He's building up a big army, as you can see. He's moving out. And so far, this is working. If you think at the army supply...
Is he trying to hit before that rubber bay even comes into effect?
Yeah, I mean, he's... Oh, actually, San gets units in.
Ooh.
And he's like, wait a minute. Where's the army? Mm. The most important part is the army. Like, where is the army?
Oh, does he see it with that... I think he might have seen it with that... Watchtower just then.
I don't think he did.
Very close.
I don't think he did.
All right, so still has to be very, very careful about this. The Stalkers, now they see exactly what's going on. And we'll have to blink away and pull back.
It's going to be hard to make this work. Yeah. Sam now sees it happening. He warps in around the units. He's got the Photon Overcharge available, defender's position. It was a good try. I mean, if there weren't extra units, maybe if it hadn't been spotted, maybe it could have been worked. Oh well.
That's kind of sad.
Yeah, I think it's time to go home and expand.
Yeah. Nice pickup there from Sam. So losing a Stalker or two for that. Not the hugest of deals. To be able to deny a Mothership Core from an engagement before it even occurs is a very, very nice kill.
But one thing that's in favor of San is that when you dedicate to a kind of attack, whether it works or not, you put resources away from somewhere into a different location, and that is the Colossus tech here. They're both going down the Colossus tech, but we see San, who dedicated to it earlier, having it out faster. So he's actually going to have a Colossus advantage here, as we already have one out and the first one just on its way. Second robotics facility actually coming in for Stardust, surprisingly. And we see a Templar Archives, which was scouted immediately there by Stardust instead.
Stardust has done a pretty good job of... it wasn't the most crippling of damage for his Nexus to die off, because obviously Santa had to commit resources to actually killing that as well and didn't quite have as much income. But so it's relatively level pegging, but he does not want to be taking an engagement just yet without his Colossi, so... Very important for them to just kind of stay stable at this point.
War Prism inside the main.
Ooh, and picking up some probes at the natural as well. So this is a good start here for Stardust to really kind of do a little bit of damage.
I like Stardust's position again.
Yeah, he's doing really good.
I really like the double robotics facility. I actually really like this in this position. To be able to really jump up with a Colossus count, they're ever so important. If you think about any Protoss versus Protoss battle, what are the damage dealers? It's the Colossus, right?
Yeah, it is.
Colossus is the damage dealer. If you're building 2x2, you're going to have a lot of damage output, guys. It's kind of simple. So I really like that addition on. And 5 extra gateways should just be in time. Oh, no.
Oh, no. San!
Oh, no.
Oh, crippling!
No.
That Colossus number. He's actually 0 against 4. If an engagement is to come now, but he's trying to capitalize on the fact that those Stalkers did go forwards, he catches a few of them off, but it's still not enough.
No.
It's not enough.
You're going for a 2-based attack, and all of a sudden you lose your 2 Colossus. This is disastrous. There's 3 out currently versus 0.
Yeah.
This is terrible news for San. Absolutely terrible.
Fourth one halfway complete.
This is disastrous, Clarus. This is such a crucial mistake for this game.
He has to somehow find a miracle now. Oh, that is not the miracle he wants at all.
There's about to be a fourth Colossus here.
You can't do anything. He has to fall back.
And you can't. That's the thing. You have to go. If you fall back and take a third, you're too far behind. You have to go. This is it. Desperate. If Sand's going to get a game, it has to be now. It needs to be now.
Desperation. Even this engagement position isn't good for Sand as he walks straight up into Stardust. Those two Colossi aren't fooling anybody here. Stardust is absolutely tearing this to pieces. And Sand plummets. He falls down completely. GG! Stardust 3-0. What is going to happen to stop him? He is just catching everything perfectly. Look at him. He can't believe it himself. He cannot believe it.
Stardust, this is a walk in the park right now. He's doing everything right. Everything's going in his way. And San is finding himself in a position that only one or two people in the world have actually come back from. And he finds that position where he needs to win four games in a row. In Protoss versus Protoss, you know how volatile this matchup can be. Four games in a row is probably one of the most difficult things there is to accomplish in StarCraft 2. It's so difficult to do. If he is able to do that, that is absolutely mind-blowing that he's able to do that. And I think this is one of the most difficult things to do. So I really think that Stardust is in prime position at the moment to be the next WCS European champion.
Yeah, it's amazing. I mean, considering I spoke to him just before this final, and he's like, he doesn't even have too much confidence in his PvP. Well, he always says that about every matchup, I guess. But he just goes into it and plays so, so well. San, not really babysitting his Colossi too well, means that, unfortunately, everything for him was shut down. But even if he had got over there, he would have still been at a Colossus deficit because of the double robo play coming out there from Stardust. So now we're going to go on to merry-go-round, game number four. And San has a huge, huge deficit to come back from. It's absolutely massive. Can he do it? Because otherwise, if not, Stardust here on the right will be our WCS Season 2 champion in Europe.
He takes the third position in the world away from San as well. Takes it for himself, pushing San to fourth.
Yeah. All right, let's get into things. Spawning up to the top right-hand corner, looking absolutely undefeatable here right now in the grand finals. Representing my insanity, it's Stardust. And up to the top left, needing to play now the series of his life to come back from the position he has found himself in. Representing Yo Flash Wolves, it's San.
Yeah, a nice and early gate coming out here from Stardust. And I think we've seen this been used once already this weekend. And we are going to see this again from him. An early rush and attack.
And if San sends his first probe the wrong way and does not get the information he needs, it's pretty difficult to deal with.
This could be a very flamboyant way to win this series here if Stardust is there. Able to close it up like this. We'll see. He's going to be aggressive from the get-go. He's going to put the pressure on pretty fast into this game as San opens up with quite a normal set of opening steps with his build order. It's the gateway down on 13, the double gas coming in, the lack of scout here. It's a three-player map. You're not really going to be scouting too early here because you're not really expecting to see any early aggression on the three-player map, or at least proxy. So he's assuming that this game is going to go to the later part of the game. He's expecting the mid game, the tech choice wars, the mind games, that part of the game. But no, look at the difference with the warp gate research. Already we have a 30 second advantage, just
huge.
Just under 30 seconds.
And if he chrono boosts fully into warp gate alone, when there's no energy for a Santa chrono boost on the other side of the map, this window that
there
is already big.
One chrono boost in already.
All right.
Other into the Stalker. This is going to prevent any form of scout here.
Yeah.
With the Stalker coming out quite fast, it's going to put a bit of it's indirect pressure. If a pro was to come out soon and was getting close to seeing what's going on, Yeah, good luck.
But he has no clue. He's not going to have a clue for a long, long time. Not only that, but I think... No, StarDust is... Well, we'll find out.
StarDust, two probes in each assimilator, focusing a lot more minerals. Another chrono boost into that. We'll see a couple of gateways come down shortly. His probes in the middle of the map. At this point, I say the one thing that could go wrong for StarDust is that maybe he loses his probe. Mm-hmm. And then he needs to send out another one, which significantly delays this type of attack. And he goes, and he doesn't know if to pull back or not, and he needs to pull back immediately here, and he doesn't want to lose that probe.
The difference in warp gate is now...
Loses the probe. That's bad. And he needs to send out another one. So that was kind of the one thing that San could kind of hold on to.
The difference in warp gate, because the Chrono Boost actually just went in for San, is now around still like 40 seconds-ish during of that. So it's still a big, big window. Stalker pokes
San's
forwards.
San's got no idea what's going on.
Yeah.
He sees a Stalker. He's like, oh, God, one Stalker beat some other shit, caught me, run back. The other Stalker's going to come in. Where is the Chrono Boost going in for San? I mean, he's got a Twilight Castle, Dark Shrine.
This is almost a replicant of what we saw from Wellmoo versus Stardust when this actually happened. But again...
I mean, there's a robotics facility coming in. We have San with a pylon on the other side of the map, but the problem is, even if he goes in the scouts, what's happening? It's already too late. It's happening now. This is it, right now.
Uh-oh. So, all right, Stalkers, if they could even do any damage to that, that would be fantastic.
Proton overcharge is ready. You can dance just outside of it on the right-hand side here.
Probes come off the line. He's trying to keep up that photon overcharge for as long as possible. Doesn't want to use it just yet because he knows the threat could potentially be coming.
And we actually have a pylon inside the main base, so this is like an immediate threat from Dark Templar there. And that Dark Shrine is not far away.
Oh, he's going with the probe, so he will actually notice that, but he doesn't really want to warp units in defensively. Yeah. He wants to be over the other side being aggressive.
Yeah, he's building a mothership core right now, which is a part of the thing that you don't have, so hopefully he can use that defensively with an observer. But right now, Stardust doesn't see the Dark Shrine, but I think he's going to guess what's going on. Now he sees the Dark Shrine, so he knows what he's pretty much going up against.
Yeah, he went in whilst the Photon Overcharge was there, trying to get some damage done where he could, but now has to pull on back. Doesn't want any of these Stalkers dying, but he's up in terms of supply pretty
But the problem is, right, you warp in a couple of units defensively, you sit with an observer, how are Dark Temple going to do anything? The only thing they can do is defend, so it's not even that much that useful at this point. These Stalkers are going to have to run away, these four, but if they come back with an observer...
Yeah, he's got to be so, so careful about how he does this. All right, one Stalker falls, but it's not the greatest of trades there for Stardust.
Twilight Council coming in here for Stardust. Imagine counter DTs or something ridiculous.
Yeah.
We'll see. There's going to be an expansion here for Stardust. Look to win the game early. Didn't happen. And the Dark Shrine did work its magic. But the next part is going to go on, and both players shall expand.
With Twilight Council behind this for Stardust, so there's the Nexus for San. Nexus is going to be coming down for Stardust in a second.
If San doesn't get detection and we do see a Dark Shrine...
Yeah, that would be really,
okay, it's
really
bad. Blink. It is just Blink.
Okay.
All right.
Come on, Nexus. Go down for Stardust. It's got all this 400 minerals. Okay, so the probes move into that now. And we'll kill a pylon down there. So not too bad for San. All in all, not too bad. How things
didn't
played
die.
Out there. Yeah, didn't die, which is a good start.
It's an important part of playing StarCraft.
Yes.
All right, so the game moves on from this position. Similar positions, but obviously the robotics facility is out faster, which is the core part of being at this part of the game, is that is the structure you want to be having and you want to be building units from at this point. Obviously, forges should be coming in shortly so that they can further themselves with the upgrades. Immortal production should be beginning soon as well. But Stardust is going to have a good look inside for free. Without the robotics facility done, without observers out, you can actually have full range and... a good look around inside.
That's very, very nice to get all of this intel without being feeling too threatened. But now seeing that being Chrono Boosted, might want to get out of there pretty quick.
Yeah, it's funny because right now Stardust is still building Stalkers. He's not added on the Sentries or Forge or anything. He's still just building Stalkers. And his unit count's quite high. So there's a clear opportunity for him to move across the other side of the map. It's 11 Stalkers to 1. And I was just having a quick look after I finished looking what the Observer was seeing. Who the Observer clearly saw all of this.
Dark Templar does spot this Stalker movement.
Immortals being made. There's double Photon Overcharge.
I think it should
be enough. But imagine like a blink inside the main base.
Yeah, it would be really good. But I think it should be enough in the end. It's
That's a lot of Stalkers. I think he could blink in the main base.
If he caught the Immortal as it came out, then...
I mean, San is expecting it too. He's got a probe there. Yeah. He doesn't want to allow this to happen.
Dark Templar at the mineral line.
Stardust jumps in. He jumps in.
All right, the Army Wolves with the Immortals, so able to back that up pretty nicely. He actually gets the Observer during all of that, but has to back on out.
Yeah, not going
to
work. He jumps down here. We'll get to try and get a couple of probes. Not working. Good attempt. Definitely good try. But unfortunately, walked into force field zealots and immortal popped out right at the correct time there.
35 workers to 33 overall, in favor of Stardust just slightly. Right. So the Dark Templars didn't really do massive amounts over the other side during all that.
So I suspect a bit of harassment, sentry, if you can, and just poke around with these stalkers, get as much value from them as you can. And at this point, this is definitely where you need to be throwing down a forge. Unless you've got some crazy strategy coming out from Stardust, the forge actually needs to come into play. Unless he's going to continue to rise up his army supply, try to go for a two-base attack, which I think could be defended quite easily with the way that Sand's set up. So the longer we see no forge, the more of an advantage we're going to see Sand take.
And I think, Sean, it's amazing. It's amazing how much these guys have butted heads in the early stages of the games and just not died and always transitioned on. They've got to give props to both of them for keeping themselves alive here.
I mean, that's the level of StarCraft we're watching. At this level of StarCraft, and if you think back to the old and Brood War days, the reason why the games were so long is because you couldn't kill the other guy because he was so good at stopping what was happening. Hence, what we're seeing a little bit more here is attempts, some work, mostly not, and the games are going a lot longer. And the correct responses were always there, the correct micro from both sides. It's just good StarCraft.
Yeah, that's how PvP unfolds nowadays. Look at the advantage that we're seeing for Sand in that plus one.
But interestingly from Sand, there's no robotics bay, and he's not really looking to push himself upwards. He's just getting Zealot Charge really fast in here. Mm. He's adding on more gateways, so he's going to a total of 6, and he's actually going to start to dramatically increase. Okay, I was going to say, if he added on more, he dramatically increases his army size, but he does throw that robotics bay in a little bit later than not. But if you look at the vision of both players, Sand saw that the robotics bay is coming in, and I suppose that would be the trigger there for him to put that down himself. Whereas Stardust, a little bit less of information he's gathered. He saw the three gateways in the main, but he hasn't seen that robotics bay or temple archives or something.
Yeah, he's got to be careful about this. He does. Plus two now started for Sam, though. Is he focusing Chrono Boosts into that? Not just yet. May have just already thrown one in, but those three gateways extra finishing up here as well for him. He's going to have a lot of reinforcement power. Three gateways additionally being added on for Stardust over his side of the map as well.
Yeah, Stalker get caught out there, but does escape. But this you shouldn't really at this point be able to break each other again, which would push again towards the third base coming in quite fast. It is a little bit more difficult for sure.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the quicker someone realizes that, the better. But counteracting that is this map and how far away a third base can be and how open it can be. You can't really defend it as well unless you set up a really nice concave in advance to be able to greet someone. Yeah. So that is merry-go-round to a T, really.
Yeah, and they're going to be expanding away from each other too. So yeah, the third bases is probably the next part of this game.
Yeah.
Temple Archives is being thrown in from Stardust. So he may try to push out. His army supply is decent. And it is hard to break your opponent if they're on two bases each. With a third base coming into play, that's a different story. Because obviously you build up probes towards that. It's 400-500 minerals thrown in there. You're out in the open a little bit more. More units. San has not spotted the Templar Archives yet. It's at the back.
Yeah, it's very far away. Very far away from to be able to spot.
It's going to be hard to hit with plus two, right? So it's going to be hard to hit the attack, I think. He should be looking for a third. If he tries to hit before plus two, his opponent will have plus two. Yeah, third is better, and you just place that down.
Yeah, with a very, very similar Colossus count. And one extra Immortal in there for San. Eventually, it's too volatile an army composition right now for them to both butt heads, and plus two to really be a big telling factor. So he's just going to continue this playing this out. He does have a good army supply. I'm not going to lie. 91 over 71, but still. Just taking that third is probably the best response here.
Yep, so the game's going to further on. One big difference, though, armor's coming in instead of plus three attack. This is very interesting. I'm not too sure why he's going for this unless he's planning an attack himself.
I think it's geared more towards warping in a lot of zealots more so than anything. But if he was doing that, he would have to hit harder before there was more colossi out. Because if you don't hit when there's only three instead of like seven or eight,
It definitely screams more of an attack because obviously you'd be wanting to get plus three, right? If you're looking to go long. But with rushing out of plus one, which is a cheaper and faster upgrade, you get a slight advantage having that upgrade. And then you're throwing it into a lot of disposable units such as zealots. Yeah, sure. It does kind of plan towards an attack here. So San, who is now climbing closer to his opponent when it comes to that upgrade, they're actually very similar. He might overtake soon. Definitely, I think this is going to be an attack. So just that one upgrade alone kind of tells us that. Big part of this game. StarDust has no idea an attack is coming. Is he going to be in position? Is he out of position?
How is
he's
this?
Currently in position. On the high ground. Yeah, this is okay.
But he's... Whoop. All right, you don't want to be sacrificing any of these zealots if you want him to get an advantage in the zealot numbers, because right now he doesn't. StarDust does. Mm. 21 against 14.
You may just start plus three after this. I don't think this is going to work.
Yeah, it was a bit weird. Not the norm, that's for sure. Still more zealots warping in. Templar Archives, very late for San. He's been making Dark Templars into Archons, which isn't exactly as cost-effective if you wanted to build a proper composition of a lot of zealots into this. So StarDust has taken a good lead in terms of the army.
Yeah, he's got a very good army, I think, StarDust at the moment. 134 to 119. Both players just sitting back for the time being. San moving forward again. And the high ground here above the third base, probably the most important part of the fight. This high ground's pretty impressive to hold. Don't want to just give it away too easily. And if you do have it away, then you want to be spread out quite well.
I'm actually quite surprised that StarDust during all of this expanded towards his opponent in the first place. I mean, technically, yes, he's expanding away from the third, but expanding to that location, it's very, very close.
And he's taking the high ground. StarDust needs to spread out here. If he spreads out, he's okay. Of course, you use the ramp to your advantage.
Yeah.
San is great up on the high ground, but as soon as he comes off that high ground, uses that ramp, he's going to funnel in, which means the time warps and the spread of StarDust is going to be quite delicious. Plus three is being made, and StarDust working on that, but his opponent isn't.
Oh, and he's actually going to push in from this angle. This is an interesting choice. He needs to pull back. He doesn't want to be taking the engagement just yet. Time warp will slow a lot of that down.
A lot of damage is being thrown into the structures here on that left-hand side, which is tanking a lot for StarDust.
Another time warp. The Zealots really aren't doing anything here for StarDust. A lot of dead weight in that. Really not doing too much.
Look at the surprise!
Yeah, he sacrificed all of his Zealots through towards that Nexus. They died off very quickly. Actually, StarDust keeping those in reserve. It's Focus taking a lot of the fire here from it. And he looks like he's going to be able to finish this.
He already knows.
Yeah, he knows he's done so much damage. San in a lot of trouble with those Stalkers as well in the mineral line. StarDust going for the clean sweep, the 4-0. Pulls the probes off the line. Congratulations. GG. StarDust is the champion with a 4-0. What an amazing performance by him. Wow.
Congratulations to StarDust. He is the WCS Europe Premier League Season 2 champion. He joins the likes of MC, MMA, MVP. What a guy. Well done to you. And of course, DuckDuck, don't want to forget that special man. Congratulations. Absolutely massive congratulations there to StarDust. Well played from him. 4-0. 4-0. A sweep by StarDust as he claims first place prize and actually now finds himself third in the WCS ranking system, taking San's third away from him. San now fourth. MC holds on to his first place for now, followed by Hyun in second, but a magnificent performance from StarDust. And finally, another championship to his name. DreamHack Summer last year, 2013. Fast forward a year later, and he's now also the European Premier League champion.
An absolute amazing performance for him. Who would have expected a 4-0 clean sweep against a player the likes of San, who has just looked so good, even in Protoss versus Protoss, throughout 2014, StarDust really proves his worth and decisively pinned who is the better at PvP there.
Yeah, I mean, StarDust definitely didn't have the best record throughout this season. He's dropped games here and there. He lost first in round of 32. He lost versus San in the round of 16.
Yeah.
But coming into the bracket, coming into the playoffs, he looked like one of the best, and he is the best. He is the current champion. He is the new reigning champion of Europe, and I'm sure Mindsanity over the moon with his performance today. And another championship to his name. Unfortunately, San drops one step further than last time, though. Third and fourth in Season 1, second place in Season 2 this year. And we'll hopefully see what he can bring for Season 3 when we come down to that. But it's a great performance and a fantastic 4-0 for StarDust.
Yeah, very, very well done. And that pretty much wraps everything up here for Season 2. What a season it's been. We said it was going to be the best season. And I think the games haven't disappointed.
Yeah, definitely a lot of games to remember. But it is now time to hand it over for the winner's ceremony.
Victory Team, to Apollo, to Kalaris, to TLO, and of course to Todd. And also a quick mention for the Muslim in the last round as well. Thank you so much for being our commentary team throughout the round of 16 and the round of 8. And also, let's not forget our observer, Mr. Funker. See, it's not just WCS America that gets cheers for Observer. We can do that here too. Okay, well done. Good job. Good job, Europe. Well done. Very good. I like that. We can compete with the Americans after all. Don't forget, WCS America finals tonight as well. You won't want to miss those from 12 o'clock Central European Summer Time. Right then, time to present some money and a trophy. First of all, though, the runner-up, a man who had not lost a single game or a single series on his way to the grand final, unfortunately just came up against a juggernaut in the final. Please make some noise for our runner-up and the winner of $15,000, San. That was a little bit cheeky, but we'll let him off that one. Maybe next season. And finally, after a very long season, the World Championship Series Europe Premier League Season 2 champion, wait for it, and winning $25,000 is My Insanity StarDust! I just want to get a very quick word with you, okay? This is your second Premier tournament that you've won, and you've swept Sand 4-0. Just explain to me what's going through your mind right now. How excited, how happy are you?
First of all, my mind was just, I'm okay because I advanced to final, then play my game, and I don't care about result, like last Dream X Summer. Then first game, I realized San have some very defensive mind. So I just try using that mind, and I was playing very risky, but anyway, he depends on me. So I'm very far ahead from for build order fight. So when I won first game, then this is mine. I realize.
Okay, all right. Well, it was yours from the very beginning. Well done. A 4-0 win. You are the champion of WCS Europe 2. Bernd Gotsman from Blizzard, the esports associate manager, please present the award. There we go. The champion, everyone. Of course, the check for $25,000. And that is just about it from another fantastic season of WCS. Season 2 has come to an end. StarDust is the champion. We have one more season to go to decide who makes the top 16 for BlizzCon. This man has made an awfully big stride towards that coveted position inside the top 16. San is already in there as well. So is MC. Europeans being represented very nicely indeed. WCS America Season 2 wraps up this evening as well with their semi-finals and grand final. And then when it all shakes out, there'll still be a few more tournaments to go. Don't forget, DreamHack Valencia offers WCS points. Gfinity does too, and so does the Intel Extreme Masters in China. There's still plenty of points up for grabs to find out who the top 16 will be at BlizzCon in 2014. From everyone here at WCS, though, in Season 2 for Europe, that's it for this season. We'll see you next year.